Now we are moving to our last session on intubation in COVID patients in emergency department. To present the lecture, I would like to invite Dr. Chamara Berugudarachi, consultant emergency physician currently attached to District General Hospital, Chilak. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good morning, dear friends, and thank you very much for GMOA and Sri Academy for this opportunity. I would like to start from where Dr. Dhillon and Dr. Bhaginder stopped while thanking them. We'll move on to a couple of case scenarios, which are hypothetical case scenarios. And you can use your chat box to answer some questions. Yeah. So case number one. This is a 45-year-old female who is a previously well patient, transferred into a district general hospital or a general hospital from a peripheral hospital. After diagnosing COVID-19 8 days back, and at that time she had only mild symptoms, but now she's getting progressively worsening dyspnea and hypoxia. And her saturation level is not responding initially to conventional oxygen therapy, as Dr. Bhaginder and Dhillon said. So they have tried some low flow devices to give oxygen and it failed with time. And they have tried high flow nasal cannula with maximum setup, 60 liters per minute, and about it can reach up to 9 to 95% of FiO2. So they have tried, but poor response. And since patient is deteriorating, they have transferred to the next level. And on admission, patient is dyspneic, having bilateral lung signs with respirator of 35. And as a last resort, assume the doctors have tried BiPAP because there is some carbon dioxide retention as well in the VBG. With 100% FiO2, initially there was some mild response, but after half an hour, they see that patient is deteriorating. The saturation drops and level of consciousness also drop. Blood pressure has dropped somewhat, blood pressure of 90 by 70. And tricky situation, you are in the emergency department of this hospital. So what would you do now? What is your next? So this x-ray is taken 2 days back and we don't know what his x-ray looks now. And so I will wait for you to have something about that. Unfortunately, I can't see the chat box. Yeah, so questions for the first few hours in ED. As per the discussion we had, so what do you think? What is the severity of this patient's illness? What is your next step in the management? So you have tried low flow devices, you have tried high flow, you have tried both high flow nasal cannula and CPAP or BiPAP, but still the patient is not responding. In fact, patient is deteriorating. What would be your next step? Do you intubate this patient or not? Since I can't see the chat box here, I assume that there are some answers here. So if you decide to intubate this patient, do you intubate the patient now? Or if not, when? And where do you perform the intubation? Do you do it in your emergency department? Do you move this patient to somewhere else? What are the safety measures do you think? Because you know this is a COVID positive patient. What are the safety measures you think doing? And what are the risks to the patient? So this patient is definitely a crashing patient. He's desaturation, she's desaturated, she's tachycardic, she's hypotensive. And how are you going to optimize this patient before intubation? And if you don't optimize this patient, properly, what will happen? Who does the intubation? And how do you set up the initial ventilator settings in the emergency department? What is the destination for this patient? So after intubation, where are you going to put this patient? And at last, how do you transport safely? So lots of questions. So let's see how we are going to answer these questions during the next 45 minutes. So we are not getting as emergency departments, we are not going to get only COVID positive patients. There are some other patients too. It is a hypothetical case number two. Lockdown time, clear roads, empty roads. A 21-year-old motorcyclist, a male patient, who has tried to do some stunts on the road, has collided with the bus. And he has got some head impact with loss of consciousness, with obvious signs of head injury. He has admitted to the district obese hospital where CT facilities are not available. And he has clear signs of head injury with GCS of 7. And there are no obvious other injuries, but he is to be transferred to a nearby district general hospital, which is 45 minutes away, for a CT brain. Again, what are the management priorities for this patient before transfer? Patient has got obvious head injury. Patient has got obviously low GCS with threatened airway. So do you intubate this patient? What are the concerns related to this intubation? Because in this COVID era, this patient does not have any contact history, any known contact history of COVID. He's not from a lockdown area. As per the information available, he didn't have any respiratory symptoms. But if you decide to intubate this patient in your emergency department, what are the precautions you need to take? Again, the same questions as per the first case. Yes, we have to think of COVID in this pandemic and this current situation in the country. We need to think of the possibility of COVID infection in this patient, because we are going to do a high-risk procedure with regard to aerosol generation. So we definitely need to think of COVID status and do some adaptations to our normal intubation procedure in this patient. So the same questions again. Who are going to intubate? Where are? What are the safety measures? What are the risks to the patient? What are risks to us? Who does the intubation? And what are the initial intubation setups as per the COVID related and as per the head injury perspective? We are not going to discuss about that a lot. And what are the destination? How are we going to transport in unknown patient with unknown COVID status? Case number three. This is a 50-year-old patient with a history of hypertension, ischemic heart disease. These days we are getting lots and lots of patients with delayed presentations, coming with 2 days of chest pain, and now coming in severe shortness of breath, but she complains of some fever as well. No history of COVID contacts, no obvious history of cough or any other COVID-related symptoms. But patient is getting more and more deterioration irrespective of the initial treatment in the emergency department. As you all might know, in the emergency department, we might not know the obvious diagnosis, but what we do is we stabilize this patient's airway, breathing, circulation, disability, and exposure. And then we do direct T-strain examination with regard to identify the cause and identify the possible measures to reverse that course. But unfortunately, this patient is not responding with, so obviously we are treating this patient as heart failure, and patient has got some fever history as well. He has received some antibiotics, but we can't get the X-ray done as well. There's no bedside ultrasound scan in this department. patient's response to GTN infusion, BiPAP, antiplatelets, furosemide antibiotics fail. He seems to be tiring on the BiPAP machine. His GCS is dropping and he's exhausting with regard to his respiratory effort. We don't know his COVID status. It's not, unfortunately, we couldn't get the rapid antigen test in both in case number 2 and case number 3. So, what are you going to do now? What are the management priorities? Again, patient has got possible heart failure, maybe possible infection. We don't know the cause. And anyway, patient has got significant breathing problem, which we can't manage with non-invasive ventilation. So, that do you intubate this patient? What are the concerns again related to intubation in this COVID pandemic? So, do we need to think of COVID-19? Obviously, yes, we need to think. And so, what are the adaptations we are going to do in this intubation? So, this is not only the story of myself, this may be the story of you all. So, I'm pretty sure this talk is listened by most of the doctors who are working from various places in the island in various circumstances. Most of the time, you don't know when you have the initial contact with the patient, you don't know about the COVID status. But you need to jump into the patient to stabilize the patient, to stabilize the RV, to give cardiopulmonary resuscitation in a patient who is unknown of COVID status. Usually, emergency department's work is really, really tricky because most of the time we get very undifferentiated patients where we need to stabilize and identify possible causes and manage. But unfortunately, to make it worse, we need to think of COVID status of these patients while we are battling with that undifferentiated ill patient. So most of the things I'm going to talk here is related to the emergency department, ATU or PCU practice, but the policy, the principles I'm going to discuss will be valuable and applicable to other setups as well. Ward setups, intermediate care centers, COVID hospitals, ICUs, as well with regard to ARV management. Keeping those questions in mind, let's recap. We know that COVID-19 is a respiratory virus. So, patient is affected with COVID-19 virus, and most of the time, the respiratory system is affected. But we all know that it can affect other systems as well. So, what we normally do is we manage the respiratory system, we then manage the other system. But now, it's tricky. While we are doing this work, we need to think of infection control as well. Because we need to safeguard ourselves. We need to think of our safety while doing the maximum to the patient. So, if I protect, I can protect my healthcare system. I can protect my staff. I can protect my family. So that even though we have got 2 jabs, it's not 100%. So, we have to be careful. We have to think of infection control as well. So, the objectives of this talk would be to factors consider when intubating a COVID-19 patient, discuss about appropriate safety measures when dealing with suspected COVID-19 patient, and factors to consider when ventilating COVID-19 patient. And I'm going through this ventilation thing very briefly because I'm just highlighting what are the initial settings in the emergency department. I'm not going to talk about hi-fi ventilator setups or management because it's very complex. It will be a very long talk. and then factors to consider when transferring COVID-19 patients who have got some airway management. The things I'm going to mention today might change tomorrow. So this COVID-19, as we all know, is evolving disease with evolving evidence. What I have read tomorrow may not be applicable today. Most of this stuff I'm going to mention here are based on international guidelines and local guidelines available by today. And most of them are, most of the time, consensus based. And there are no evidence for some of these things. They are practical based and consensus based, so that it can change. And the most importantly, depending on where we work, everything I'm going to mention may not be applicable to our setup. But if we know the ideal thing we should do, we can try to make it possible as much as possible. Even though we don't have adequate staff, adequate trained staff, we may not be having adequate space, we not be having adequate systems, we may not be having adequate stuff, adequate equipment to do all the things I'm going to mention here. But if we know the correct thing, at least we can try, we can aim at achieving that in order to protect ourselves and protect our patients. Okay, so as per the three cases I mentioned, any patient coming to the emergency department who needs some kind of airway management, if we can't manage that airway with simple airway maneuvers and simple airway jumps, we might need to go for an intubation. Basically, if the patient has got some airway problem, yes, we have to manage that. If the patient has got some breathing problem, may be related to COVID-19 or may not be related to COVID-19, yes, we have to manage. So there are cases which are related to COVID-19 where we need to manage airway, and there are cases we get COVID-19 suspected or positive patients who are getting respiratory failure who need ventilator support with invasive ventilation. So those are the patients I'm going to discuss in details, but always remember, any patient, if we can't exclude COVID-19 for sure, we need to adhere to these principles. So I think Dr. Bagind has explained quite well about pathophysiology of COVID, but basically the alveolar cells of the lung is attacked by viral load and it's attached by systemic inflammatory response, and which can cause the problems with compliance and atelectasis, and it can cause some microthrombosis of the pulmonary arteriole and capillaries, and ultimately which can cause hypoxemic respiratory failure. In brief, that's what So patient will end up in hypoxemic respiratory failure. So far during the last two lectures, you heard how we are going to manage hypoxemic respiratory failure with low flow oxygen devices and high flow oxygen devices. So I think you have now familiar with this diagram, which is prepared by College of Pulmonologists and Anesthetists. So basically, as Dr. Bagind and Dr. Dylan has mentioned, so we are going for low flow oxygen devices and we are going for the high flow oxygen devices. And finally, if we can't meet oxygenation saturation and if we can't decrease the work of breathing with these devices, we have to go for invasive mechanical ventilation so that we need to intubate the patient. And then you have already, someone has drawn on my screen, that's fine. So as you have already heard, so patient's disease severity can be categorized as mild, moderate and severe. Most of them is severe patients. Patient with severe illness needs failing high flow oxygenation and failing non-invasive ventilation, invasive ventilation. So I'm not going to go into more detail in this graph here on the table. And you have already seen what are the low flow devices, nasal cannula to non-treat with the bag, and high flow, high pressure devices like high flow CPAP and ventilator setups. Okay, indications for intubation. If the patient is diagnosed or suspected of having COVID-19, basically they are intubated due to oxygenation failure. There is no defined saturation target for oxygenation, but it is altogether a clinical decision based on the numbers and the patient's condition. And patient, if the patient, even though the numbers are good, if the patient is having respiratory distress, not just tachypnea, respiratory distress, the involvement of accessory muscles and inability to complete a sentence in one breath, and if we are tiring, yes, we need to go for intubation. And the clinical trajectory, this is sometimes it's not that applicable to the emergency department setup, but in ward setup and in ICUs, if the patient is deteriorating irrespective of these treatment modalities, yes, we need to go for intubation and ventilation. Okay, so intubation and ventilation is a double-edged sword because we need to think about the patient care. If the patient is not intubated at correct time, it's not good for the patient. On the other hand, as I mentioned, as per the international evidence, in earlier stage of COVID-19 pandemic, 1 in 10 intubation would lead to, they found that would lead to transmission to of COVID-19 to healthcare worker. So it's a high-risk procedure for the staff too. And if we decide this patient needs intubation, we need to decide when we are going to do that, because it's said that COVID-19 intubation should be safe, it should be accurate, and it should be safe. It should be safe to the staff and the patient, that, and it should be accurate, and because patient, we should try for the first pass success of the intubation. We can't allow patient to have 2 or 3 attempts of intubation. And this intubation should be swift. That's most important, timely. In earlier stages of COVID-19 in European countries and in China, they thought that early intubation would be better. If the patient deteriorates, without depending on high flow devices, high flow nasal cannula and CPAP, BiPAP, they went into intubation. But later they found that it is detrimental to the patient. That means it can cause lots of ventilator-induced lung injury and systemic injuries. So their outcome was poor. And now recommendation is, we don't have to do, it's a balance. We don't have to go for very early intubation. At the same time, we can't wait for the patient to have multi-organ dysfunction and patient crash intubation. That will definitely affect the patient in a detrimental way. At the same time, if we rush in front of a deteriorating, a crashing patient, if we rush for intubation, there's high chance that we can fail. We can fail in 2 ways. We can fail our procedure. We can fail our intubation. At the same time, we can fail with regard to our protection. We can fail in donning and doffing of PPE. We can fail in the proper technique of intubation. So it is not good for the patient and it's not good for the healthcare staff. That's why we say this intubation has to be safe, it should be accurate, and it should be timely or swift. Okay, intubation procedure. We should prepare well and we should do the intubation in a proper way, and we should give post-intubation care properly. We say that intubation in emergency department always is a difficult procedure. All the intubation in emergency department are difficult intubations. That's why we always try to use checklists. It's a complicated, complex procedure. So, for example, if pilot is flying an aeroplane, usually how they do that is always they adhere to a set of checklists. Likewise, in emergency department, in any intubation, which is a complicated procedure, always in one step it can go wrong and it can affect the patient's outcome. So that we always advocate using checklist for intubation. But now with this COVID pandemic, with COVID related concern, it has become more complex, more complicated. That's why we always advise you to follow a checklist. There are number of checklists available. You can browse and see there are various checklists available made by various institutions. And this is one of them, just I got from internet literature. And this looks complicated, but it's very comprehensive. That's why I selected this for this staging session. And you can see most of these steps are at the preparation phase. And then in the room, we do these procedures. So let's see how we are going to do. Fine. So the first step, the preparation, in the preparation, we need to think about our personal protective equipment, that is PPE. I'm really happy that we saw a donning and doffing procedure. Donning and doffing procedure video. So I'm really happy that you highlighted the importance of accurate donning and doffing of these patients. So we need to think, what are the adequate and appropriate level of PPE we need to use in these patients? And at this time in the world, there's a huge supply versus demand mismatch of PPE, even in developed countries. So what about us? So we definitely have some issue with the supply demand, with the supply demand of the PPE. That's why we need to understand the rationale and we need to know what is the appropriate PPE for these procedures. So this is where the term aerosol jetting procedure come into play. We know by this time COVID-19 is transmitted in three ways. It can be transmitted with direct contact, it can go with droplets, it can go with aerosols. The droplet is a little bit of larger particle or larger droplet which does fall. On the other hand, aerosol is a very small droplet which is less than 5 microns, which does float in the air. That's why if we generate aerosols, that smaller particle is, it can float on the air for some times. Now it says it can float up to 3 hours, but the most effective period these aerosols can contaminate, this aerosol can give infection to someone, is said to be around 1.5 hours. So at the beginning of this pandemic, they have described various sort of aerosol-aiding procedures, from intubation to extubation to CPR to high flow nasal cannula. So this is the list. It has many. And now, with now current evidence is coming up, challenging high flow nasal cannula whether it's a really aerosol-aiding procedure with regard to a normal cough, which produce about 400 liters per minute of flow. And we know that high flow has got only 60 liters per minute. So it is being challenged. But to the moment, it's always prudent to think these all these procedures are aerosol generating for safety. And after the aerosol generating procedures, in some literature, they have described as aerosol generating behaviors as well, like screaming, shouting, crying out, vomiting, and talking without mask. And now with the current MSIG, you must have heard that it is airborne disease. Now it is considered airborne disease. So if I talk in a confined space without the mask, yes, it can contaminate, it can produce this aerosol. So that it's pretty obvious that it is mainly aerosol or airborne. So that in a disease which is airborne, if we do an aerosol generating procedure, which generate lots of aerosol generating procedure, we have to be really, really careful. That's why I'm highlighting intubation, which is an aerosol-generating procedure, has to be taken really seriously, very seriously, and take all the precautions to avoid us healthcare workers being contaminated and being infected. So we have heard about various levels of PPI. I will go through these things very briefly. Level 1 PPE, level 2 PPE, level 3 PPE. Level 1 PPE is we take a surgical mask, non-permeable or waterproof long sleeve gown, gloves, and optional head cover, and optional face shield as well. In level 2 PPE, so we have replaced the surgical mask to the N95 or equivalent or higher. So other than that, it has that, other than the N95 mask, it has got face shield, non-permeable long sleeve gloves, and optional, Donnie and Duffin video explained, it has optional shoe covers as well. But in level 2 PPE, we can see there are some spaces in the body which is open to the environment. So when we come to level 3 PPE, there's no open areas of the body. It covers whole body, including necks and the legs and shoes. So what is the recommendation as per the current guidelines for aerosol generating procedures like intubations? Because we all know that aerosols can contaminate us and we can be infected. And as per the current literature, what they recommend is level 2 PPE for intubation or other aerosol-aiding procedures. It can be level 3 if it is available, but level 2 is WHO and local guideline recommend level 2 and level 2 PPE or above. And you might have seen that over coveralls, which is what we call a bunny suit, which has a zipper and we can jump into that. And we, most of the time when in the healthcare staff we see that patients are, the healthcare staff is using coveralls. It is a level 3 PPE, it's a part of level 3 PPE. It's not a harm to use that if it is available. But always we need to know how to don these PPE and how to doff it properly. Because as per the literature, most of the time, healthcare staff in the world is infected with COVID-19, not because they don't have PPE, but they don't know how to don and how to doff PPE. That's why I think that the video, the awareness of the donning and doffing process is very important. So if you use a coverall, I have put it up, but it is very difficult to don and off without getting contaminated. That's why I am emphasizing, if you do it properly, doff it properly without getting contaminated. Okay, this is the WHO guidelines. So it recommends level 2 PP with the optional neck cover, head cover and shoe covers. And this is the local Sri Lankan guidelines, which also explain the same. So we don't need to go for higher PP unnecessarily. But if it is available, that's fine. But you need to know proper don and doff procedures. And this is very important thing. So always use PPE for patients. What I mean from PPE is you give a surgical or medical mask to the patient when they come to the institution. Especially if the patient is given nasal cannula oxygen, high flow or in non-invasive ventilation, try to put a face mask over their oxygen delivering device. That will prevent, minimize aerosol generation. And never ever forget 5 moments of hand hygiene. Never ever forget proper donning and doffing procedure. I'm not going to discuss this, but I emphasizing, please use it properly and always use your body system as mentioned in the video. Okay, so we are in the preparation phase of our intubation now. So to come back to our proper lesson. So we are discussing about intubation checklist with regard to COVID-19 intubation. So we are in the preparation phase. We discuss about personal protective equipment, and then we need to think about allocated roles. So again, as I mentioned, these things might not be available in your department or in your hospital. You may not be having this much of space for isolation rooms, in negative pressure rooms, but if you know the basics, if you know the correct way, you can at least try to reach to that level, because these are for our safety. Okay, so idea is we have to minimize people inside the patient's area, patient's room, when we are doing a aerosol generating procedure like intubation. So mainly what is recommended is 3 people inside, 1 person to intubate, 1 person to work till act as the team leader, and the same person to administer drugs, and 1 person to help with the intubation, to pass the bougie and the tube, and sometimes to apply the burp manually. So if we have a negative pressure room, that's fine. If we have isolation room, that's better. But if you don't have any, we can aim for that. But that is a recommended thing. And always we need to plan in between these healthcare staff team members before going into the room. So inside the room, we have got 3 people, and outside there's a runner with full PP in case if we need some additional help, and outside we can have the scribe and second runner as well. And we can have this checklist inside room so that we don't have to communicate with exterior always. But you need to have, if we are doing this procedure inside the room, maybe inside your HDU, maybe inside your ICU, there should be some kind of communication, maybe with a speakerphone with the exterior. Otherwise, you can't communicate in case of difficulty. And as I mentioned, so we have to try for the first pass intubation. So in COVID era, we might need to give this chance to the most experienced person in our team. And so that is the preparation phase. So in the preparation phase, number 2 is preparing of the equipment, because when you go inside the room or the inside the patient's area, we can't have each and everything passed from in and out. So we have to have a proper checklist and take whatever necessary inside. And I'm not going to go into detail, but there are some preset COVID-19 intubation checklist, intubation equipment checklist. You can use one of them. And you have to take adequate amount of drugs inside. You have to take adequate amount of drugs to fully paralyze and fully sedate this patient, because we don't need patient to buff on the tube while we are doing, which can cause drops of aerosol generation, which can affect our safety. And we have to know about patient's existing medical conditions and their weight and everything when we go, before we go inside the room. Okay, so we have to, before going to the room, we have to prepare for the difficulty as well. So we might know about the assessment of difficulty and the in failing the first attempt, we have to go for the plan A, plan B, plan C, and plan D. So this topic is beyond the aim of my talk today, so that I'm not going to talk in detail, but always keep in mind that you have to prepare for difficulty, anticipated or unanticipated difficulty. So in case, even though you are not getting all these equipments inside the room, there should be some kind of communication to get this equipment for the plan B and plan C if the ARV attempt, intubation attempt, has not gone as per plan. Okay, so now we are going into the room. So we have prepared well, we have set our equipments and our team, and we are going into the room. What are we going to do inside the room? So first thing, in front of the patient, we can visually assess the patient's ARV, the difficulty of ARV. So we can use Levin mnemonic, or we can use Nemcocha score, whatever convenient to us. And then monitoring has to be in place properly. Careform capnography in this situation is extremely important. So that I always advise, if possible, to have wave of capnography and IV access, possibly optimizing the positioning to minimize intubation failures, and pre-oxygenation. This is very important. If the patient is diagnosed to have COVID-19, they have really sick lungs. So their apneic time is less than a normal patient, or compared to a patient coming with a road traffic accident with healthy lungs, this patient has got very sick lungs. So their apneic time will be very low. And to make it worse, we might be starting for the intubation procedure with some relative hypoxemia. The saturation may not be adequate. Our aim should be to optimal pre-oxygenation to make this apnea time as long as possible. Otherwise, there's high chance that patient get desaturation and patient get crashed while we are doing the intubation procedure. So at least 3 minutes of pre-oxygenation is advised. And if the patient is breathing spontaneously, we can use our bag valve mask with highest flow available, 15 liters, for the patient to breathe in and out. And we can use Mipel's cease circuit if it is available, or anesthetic circuit if it is available. It is very important if we can apply some kind of PEEP during this pre-oxygenation phase. That will be very beneficial for this pre-oxygenation phase. If you are doing it with the bag valve mass oxygenation, we can't achieve that kind of peak. But if you listen to some kind of international podcast, international literature, and free online medical education resources, you might have heard of Scott Weingart, one of the leading emergency physicians. And he has described in his videos very nicely how to change this bag valve mask with the additional oxygen input to have some kind of PEEP up to 5 to 10 liters while we are doing the pre-oxygenation. But the idea should be to do proper pre-oxygenation. And if patient is breathing, don't bag wear mask, don't press the bag. So let the patient breathe. If we ever want to bag wear mask manually during pre-oxygen, we have to avoid if possible. Always use a proper rib. Use forehand technique. One person to have a good seal with the patient with the mask. So you can, this is vice grip that is recommended. With some other person to very slowly bag the patient. If it is available, video laryngoscope is preferred, but it is not that much widely available. And always, always use a viral filter in between the mask and the bag well mask or the ventilator circuit. Okay. And at last, this thing. Optimizing the patient. If, as I mentioned, these patients are really sick, they are hypoxic, they can be having some circulatory failure as well. So if we go for intubation without proper optimization, as in our first case, there's high chance they'll get a cardiac arrest while we are doing the procedure. So we need to give adequate fluids, we need to give vasopressors, and we need to optimize oxygenation before doing. That is for the patient's safety, and we have to do, if we are deciding that patient needs intubation, we have to go for intubation early before patient gets crashed with proper planning. This is the bag well mask with additional oxygen input to get some PEEP, and as I mentioned here, always we need to use a viral filter in between the patient and the ventilator. Okay, so as I mentioned, do not face mask ventilator unless needed. That means a manual compression of the bag. A 2-person low flow, low pressure technique if it is really needed. And when we intubate, so after that we can directly visualize the laryngoscope, and always we need to directly visualize the tube going past in the vocal cords, and we have to try to avoid interbronchial intubation. And always in the emergency department intubation, you might have heard this before, in emergency department intubation, which is a non-controlled environment, it's not a controlled environment, most of the time we are in front of a crashing patient who are really, really sick. So we are not going to be too adventurous sometimes, so that we always, most of the time, we use bougie to intubate. But if you are quite confident, you can avoid bougie, but it's always, we always advocate using bougies. So in this case also, use a bougie if it is available. And if you use a bougie, always after intubation, take it out slowly. Don't just take it out, it can produce lots of droplets and aerosols, and there's a high chance of contamination. So these are some practical points. And we are in full PEEP, so we can't auscultate this patient. And after that high aerosogenic procedure, we don't want to go near the patient chest or mouth, so that with unnecessary contamination. So for the confirmation of the tube position, yes, we have visually inspected the tube going through the vocal cords. We can check for the chest rise, whether it is adequate and whether it is symmetrical. And we can always use the capnogram to confirm the position. And at last, if we have some kind of chest X-ray, yes, we can confirm the position. But we don't advise, and it is not that practical to auscultate these patients. Always, after this intubation, before attaching into the bag well mask or the ventilator, always clamp the tube, put the viral filter, and then attach the ventilator, which is in standby mode, which is not running. It should be in standby mode, and you clamp the tube, viral filter, standby mode ventilator, you attach the ventilator to the tube, and then you unclamp, and then turn on the ventilator. So that is all to prevent unnecessary aerosol generation. Okay. Now we have intubated. Sorry, I could mention that always just after intubating the patient, you take the tube, the bougie out, and before attaching the bag valve mask, always you have to make sure that the cuff is inflated. You don't bag without cuff inflated because it can produce lots of aerosols. And then, as I mentioned, shape wave for capnography. And when you attach this ventilator or these viral filters, always attach them properly. You have to push, you have to twist to avoid unnecessary circuit disconnections. And after, from this point, all the time, if we disconnect the ventilator or any part of the tubing, you need to clamp the tracheal tube. And then, if it is needed, necrosis tube should be added, and tube should be can be inserted. And then, careful equipment disposal. And after intubation, most of the time we are in some joyful mood, and we forget all the precautions, infection control precautions we have taken, and we put all these equipments everywhere. So we have to dispose these equipments properly without getting contaminated. And then doffing of the PPE should be done very carefully with the help of a buddy. Someone has to watch. And then I have mentioned this, the procedure to connect to the ventilator. And after that, patient has to be sedated properly. And if needed, we might need to paralyze the patient as well, because we don't want patient to fight with the ventilator, which can cause lots of bucking and service disconnection and dislodgements. Okay, that is the basic intubation procedure. So as I mentioned, I'm not going to go into detail about ventilation, but in emergency department, into a ward, initial setup, until this patient is moved to ICU, a proper care for intensive care, this patient should be put on the ventilator model, ARDS protocol. So we usually go for the PEEP of 10. Usually, we have, I think you might know that we can start the ventilator on volume control mode or pressure control mode. We try to, we like to be very simple in this messy environment. We like to be simple, and I always prefer going for the volume control mode initially. So what I do is, PEEP 10, 6 milliliters per kilogram of tidal volume, SI mimo respirator of 12 to 16, and we have to make sure that the plateau pressure is less than 30. That is the basic initial setups. And after that, you might have heard about type 1 lungs, type 2 lungs, based on their dynamic and static compliance. And there are different ventilator modalities for that. So that is not a part of this talk today. It is beyond the scope of this lecture, but if you can adhere to this ventilator setup, that is more than enough. So you can, so you might have known about that incremental FiO2 PEEP table of the ARDS network, and if you feel that patient is FiO2, more and more FiO2, you can increase PEEP as well. So that's all regarding ventilation of this patient in this emergency department until this patient is disposed to a ICU care. And always don't give unnecessary fluid pulses if the patient is hemodynamically stable, because dry lungs are happy lungs. It will definitely affect the ventilation. Okay, I'm moving to the last part of the lecture. So barrier devices. We know when at the start of the first wave, second wave, there were lots of barrier devices came into play, intubation boxes and aprons and bags like that. So far, none of these devices are proven to be effective. In fact, they can cause some kind of harm to the patient and harm to the healthcare staff. So that is not recommended to the moment. Okay, last part. Now we have managed patient's ARV. Now we have to move this patient to a definitive location from the emergency department or from the ward. It may be an intra-hospital transfer, it can be an inter-hospital transfer. The basics are the same. This patient now has got a closed circuit. So there's minimal chance that patient get aerosolized. But still, there's a chance of contamination from the patient's contact and from inadvertent, unexpected circuit disconnections. So the transfer should be minimal. Unless it is really necessary, we should not have that risk. And all the time, if we disconnect any tubing, we have to clamp the tube. We always recommend you to use a transport ventilator, and we don't recommend to use a back valve mask. I know this is ideal. In real scenarios, you might need to use, but try to avoid. And proper communication with the destination to minimize delays, because more and more the time is spent in between, there's more and more harm to the patient and us. And there should be no en route delays, and always try to use a runner to hold limbs and clear the passages. And if the patient is on ventilator, even though patient is on high flow or CPAP, BiPAP, we can put a drape or a mask over that device. If the patient is intubated, patient is unconscious, we can put a drape over the patient's face for additional safety. Those are some basic principles for transferring of these patients. In summary, all intubations are difficult. In current circumstances, all intubations, we have to think these are COVID intubations. Intubation has to be decided, because I did not touch about the goals of care, ceiling of care, because always when we do an intubation, we have to think twice, thrice, whether this intubation is needed, whether this patient will benefit. If the patient has got bad lungs, yes, patient is having multi organ dysfunctions, ARDS, and DIC due to COVID, will this patient be benefited from the intubation? That has to be thought. Always think of the ceiling of care when we start non-invasive ventilation, whether we need to escalate this patient for invasive ventilation. So that can be based on patient's clinical circumstances, patient deterioration, patient age, other comorbidities, and there are some scoring symptoms like C+ scores used internally. I don't know, to my knowledge, it's not used in Sri Lankan setup to the moment. There are some prognostication tools like scores, so we can use that. So that always you have to think of the outcome of the intubation, because we have got limited ICU capacity. So that with your seniors, with your consultants, always think twice, thrice, whether this patient is going to be intubated, whether the patient will have a good outcome. In European or Western evidence, ARDS and COVID-related mortality is around 50% if they are intubated. In COVID situation, it is lesser, higher than that. The mortality is higher. But in our circumstances, with our facilities, I'm pretty sure it will be higher. So that intubation may not be the answer for everything. So that is an additional point I need to mention, but always take the decision, depending on the patient clinical scenario, and use with the help of your seniors. And if you are going to intubate, it has to be timely. Always think about your proper PPE, donning and doffing. And yeah, these for protocol, and limit transport as much as possible. This is my reference, and thank you very much for listening, and thank you very much for this opportunity. If you have any questions, I'm more than happy to answer. Okay, there are
questions.
Yes, I will start from the bottom and go up. Do we need level 2 PP to do PCR in intubated and sedated patient with suspected chest X-ray? Very interesting question. The risk of doing a PCR is that there's a chance that it can aerosolize particles, viral particles. In a patient who is intubated, sedated, and assume that it is paralyzed, there's low chance patient can cough or patient can produce anything. But as per a protocol, as far as I know, we use PPE for that. Actually, when we go a little bit further, so we are doing PCR for dead bodies. I have seen even for that procedure, we are wearing full PPE. But actually, in the theoretically and practically, I'm not pretty sure whether it is an aerosol-generated procedure. But I advise you, use your institutional protocol for that. So that you must have some kind of protocol in your institution. Even though technically it can't generate aerosols, especially in a paralyzed and sedated patient, as per the protocol, we might know it, but it sounds a little bit of a problem. What are the airway secretion management techniques during intubation? Yes, you can use some glycopyrrolate to minimize secretions during intubation. And always before, so one advice we can give to the patient is, if the patient is conscious, swallow all the secretions patient has got. And if the patient is not that conscious, we can suck out the secretion with that appropriate PPE. But you can use glycopyrrolate if it's not available. You can use atropine acid, but not the best. But that's how we reduce secretions. And when you go up, I think Dylan has answered one question. Does oxygen supply with Hudson mask generate aerosols without nebulization? So Hudson mask is a low flow, low pressure device. So technically, it does not cause aerosol generation as for the high flow devices. But if it is a, yes, but with the current evidence, it says even though you talk without the proper mask, it can generate aerosols. But there's some kind of risk, but it is not mentioned aerosol generating procedure, Hudson's mask. It's a low flow device. Let's go up. I think there are lots of those are the questions. Thank you very much. Actually, during scenarios, I couldn't see these comments. Sorry for that. Yes, need intubation. I think that's correct. I think I answered most of the questions you have asked. And if there's anything else, I'm happy to answer. Yes, atropine we can use. That's anti-muscarinic. Yeah, but a glycopyrrolate is what is recommended, but you can use atropine if it is not available. Wearing a surgical mask in ICU is adequate, or do we need to wear KN95? If you are working in an ICU where COVID suspected or COVID positive patients are treated, my advice is wear a N95 or equivalent, because with evidence in ICU, definitely you must be doing some kind of aerosol generating procedures. Number one. Number two, even with their cough, even with their talk, even they cry, they can produce aerosols. In an ICU where the humidity is low, especially in this confined space, I mentioned about these droplets and aerosols. the size of the aerosol, the size of the ability of the floating of this aerosol depend on their size. We said if it is less than 1 micron, there's high chance it can float. In low humid conditions, these ICOs with air conditioner can evaporate more and more water from the droplets, and they can become more and more smaller. They can become smaller, so that floating time can be more. So my advice, if you are treating suspected or COVID patients, please wear N95 or higher or equivalent. Did I answer all your questions?
Since there are no more queries, I would like to thank to Dr. Chamara Berugoda Arachchi for his excellent presentation on behalf of the GMOA COVID Coordinating Center and GMOA Sri Knowledge Academy. There's another one more question, sir.
Can we use vented mask, or how can we use non-vented mask in the night? Okay, this has to be very clear. If you use BiPAP, you need the vented mask. What will happen if the patient does not have a vented mask is patient will suffocate. So there should be some kind of experiment. You can use either vented mask or vented port in the tubing system, so that if it is BiPAP, NIV BiPAP, to avoid patient suffocating, we need to use a vented mask. What are the drugs best to use during intubation? Yeah, we can use ketamine. That is ketamine. So basically, you have a you need paralytics, you need anesthetic drug or the sedative drug. So basically, we can use sucks for your paralytic, and ketamine is pretty good. If the patient it's hemodynamically wise and patient's respiratory drive, everything is better. Only problem is it can cause a little bit of more secretions. You can tackle it with some kind of glyphosate or something. If it is not that problem, I would recommend ketamine plus sucks, or you can use propofol as well. I think that's all.
There's a kind reminder to fill the post evaluation form also. And thank you very much, sir. I would like to thank Dr. Dila Netra Singh, the consultant emergency physician, Dr. Baginda Gunawardana, consultant emergency physician, and Dr. Chandra Berugoda Arachchi, consultant emergency physician. And Dr. Indika Lala Roy, consultant emergency physician, National Hospital, who is the firm president of Sri Lanka College of Emergency, and Dr. Nandana Jayatilaka, consultant emergency physician, teaching hospital Peradeniya, who is a former council member, Sri Lanka College of Emergency. Thank you all for the kind sharing of the knowledge, which is really important for the management of COVID patients. And again, I'm thank you all on behalf of GMOA COVID Coordinating Center and GMO Sri Knowledge Academy. Thank you very much, sir. And thank you all for your participation.